contact us to avail the combo offer of General Studies and Public Administration optional with 20% discount.
Hello everyone, welcome to Lukman IAS. Today we are going to have the Hindu newspaper analysis dated 26th of June 2021. So let us see the list of articles that are important for the day. We are going to cover these articles that are important for the prelims and mains examination, and these articles were covered in the Hindu newspaper in these respective pages. Okay, so now let us quickly see the first topic for the day. Okay, so this particular article says that DRDO test enhanced range Pinaka rocket. Okay, so this particular article is important from the prelims point of view. And this article is covered under science and technology section. Okay, here we need to understand that what is Pinaka. Okay, Pinaka is the name of a rocket that the DRDO has tested recently. And what do we mean by range? Okay, so when we talk about a rocket like this, here you can see a image of a rocket launcher. Okay, so this is image of a rocket launcher. And this is what is called rocket. Okay, so let's consider rockets are launched from here. It will follow a path and finally it will drop to a predefined location. So this is the actual path that is followed by the rockets, or this is also known as projectile. And the distance that it covers, the horizontal distance that it covers from point A, launching point, to point B where it strikes, this particular distance is known as range. Okay, this is known as range. So recently the Defense Research and Development Organization has tested the enhanced range, means like earlier also we had the Pinaka rocket, but now we have modified the rocket so that like we can have a greater range. Okay, so let's consider this was the earlier range. Now if they have tested, the range may be little higher, okay, A dash to B dash. Okay, so that's the thing. Now let us understand in detail about this particular article. And this article also says that the target can be at distances up to 45 kilometers. Okay, distances means range of the target can be at 45 kilometers away. Okay, so let us read the context in which it was a news, and we are also going to see some details about these rocket systems. Okay, UPSC has earlier asked in prelims examination related to the type of rocket and whether it is air to air or surface to air or surface to surface. Okay, type of missiles they have asked. Okay, so that's why it is very important for you to understand different parameters associated with this. Okay, and here in this article we are also going to understand this particular integrated test range, which is located at Chandipur in Odisha. UPSC has asked a specific question that had its answer, which is Chandipur, in recent years, in I don't remember the exact year, 2018 or 19. Okay, so that's why it is very important for you to focus on different aspects of a particular article so that you can answer the questions. Okay, questions are little bit tricky in nature in the prelims exam, so that's why it is very important for you to focus on different aspects of an article. Okay, so the Defense Research and Development Organization, which is in short known as DRDO, it has successfully test fired the enhanced range version of indigenously developed 122 millimeter caliber rocket. Okay, so this was one of the rocket that has been tested, okay, by the DRDO. And apart from this, as well as an extended range version of indigenously developed Pinaka rocket. Okay, so this is the second rocket. Okay, there are two rockets that are being discussed in this particular article. One of the rocket is indigenously developed 122 millimeter caliber rocket, and the second one is extended range version of indigenously developed Pinaka rocket from a multi-barrel rocket launcher, okay, which is in short known as MBRL. Okay, so the image that you can see over here, this is truck type of thing that you can see, and this is the multi-barrel, means like at the same time they can launch multiple rockets. So this is known as multi-barrel rocket launcher system. Okay, so they have tested both these things. One of the rocket is 122 millimeter caliber rocket, and second is indigenously developed Pinaka rocket. Both the rockets were indigenously developed, means they have been developed by the technology and know-how that India has. Okay, so they did not use any foreign material for this particular purpose. Okay, and this enhanced rocket system would replace the existing 122 millimeter grade rockets. Okay, so now they are with this particular enhanced system, they will be able to replace the existing 122 millimeter grade rocket. Now we have enhanced, okay, rocket that has greater range as compared to the existing ones. And apart from this, the enhanced range version of Pinaka rocket system can destroy target at distances of up to 45 kilometers. Okay, and so these rockets have been developed by, you know, these institutes that are mentioned here. They have been developed by Pune-based Armament Research and Development Establishment and High Energy Material Research Laboratory, with manufacturing support from Economic Explosives Limited. Okay, so this is all about this particular, you know, launch system. And in your free time, you can locate where is the location of Chandipur. Okay, it is located in a beach. Okay, in Odisha. So it is very near to the, you know, Indian Ocean region or Bay of Bengal region. Okay, so you can locate this particular location also in your free time. That will give you an added advantage in answering questions in prelims exam. Okay, so having understood that, now let us take another article for the day. This article says India-China plans 12th round of talk on Ladakh standoff. Okay, so this particular article is very important under India, you know, international relations. And this article talks about bilateral relations between India and China. Okay, so this is important for the mains examination under IR section. Okay, so what is the case? The commander level dialogue aims at complete disengagement. Okay, so there were reports and there were, you know, recent standoff between India and China at, you know, various locations where India and China share some border. Okay, so now India and China both have agreed that they are going to disengage from the places where they have had standoff with one another. Okay, so now both the parties are looking forward so that they can resolve the conflicts, okay, in the border areas. And at the same time, they are holding different level of talks. Commander level talks is going to be held, and this particular talk will, you know, look forward for complete disengagement at standoff fronts. Okay, so here now let us look at this particular map. Okay, let us try to understand what are the locations where we had a standoff, and at the same time, what is this particular, you know, border area called. Okay, so we have had a standoff at Galwan Valley. This is one of the location. Then at Hot Springs, this is the second location, and then at Pangong So Lake. Okay, so these are the three places where, you know, we had recently standoff. Okay, between there was a standoff between India and China. Okay, so Indian Army and you know, People's Republic Army of China. Okay, so like they had their own army, so like there was an standoff in this region. And the border area where this particular, you know, standoff has happened is known as line of actual control. Okay, in short, it is known as LAC. It is known as LAC. Okay, so here we can see that like the regions like Aksai Chin, okay, which is a Chinese administered area, okay, it is located over here. Then we have Siachen Glacier also, and this is one of the location that was ceded by Pakistan to China. Okay, so, and if we talk about the bordering areas between India and Pakistan, it is known as line of control. Okay, and bordering areas between India and China is known as line of actual control. Okay, so this is, you know, Jammu and Kashmir, and this is Ladakh, okay, of India. So these are, this is the, you know, this is the map that will help you to, you know, visualize the things at an easy manner. Okay, So this particular recent article is with reference to India's and China's willingness to cooperate with one another to de-escalate the situation in those, you know, areas where they have had standoffs. Okay, so agreeing on the need to find an early resolution on remaining issues along the line of actual control in the eastern Ladakh, India and China agreed to hold 12th round of military commander talks at an early date to achieve complete disengagement from all the friction points along the line of actual control in the western sector. Okay, what is western sector? Basically Chinese, okay, they have named their bordering areas with India as eastern sector, middle sector and western sector. So this particular, you know, bordering area between India and China is known as western sector for China. Okay, so this is one thing, and this particular agreement, okay, between both the countries to hold 12th commander level dialogue was agreed at the 22nd meeting of the Working Mechanism for the Consultation and Coordination on India-China Border Affairs. Okay, that was held virtually, means like they recently held online talks with one another. That was 22nd meeting of the Working Mechanism for Consultation and Coordination, and in that particular meeting they have decided that they will hold 12th, okay, 12th means earlier 11 round of talks has already happened at the commander level between both the countries. Now 12th round of talk is going to happen, okay, between the commander level. Okay, so having understood this, let us understand what were the, you know, what were the statements issued by both the party. Okay, so Ministry of External Affairs of India said that in this regard the two sides agreed to maintain dialogue and communication through the diplomatic and military mechanism to reach a mutually acceptable solution for complete disengagement from all friction points so as to ensure full restoration of peace and tranquility to enable progress in the bilateral relations. Okay, so this was the statement that was made by the Ministry of External Affairs India. Okay, and if we talk about, you know, the other statement, the Ministry of External Affairs also said that they also agreed in the interim the two sides will continue to ensure stability on the ground and prevent any untoward incident. Okay, then apart from this, if we talk about, like, you know, what was the statement, okay, that was made by the Chinese side. Okay, so Indian delegation in this particular thing was led by the additional secretary East Asia from the Ministry of External Affairs, while the Chinese delegation was led by the Director General of the Border, Boundary and Oceanic Department of the Chinese Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Okay, so both from both sides there was high level talk, and in that high level talk they have decided that they are going to cooperate with one another so that they can de-escalate completely in those areas where they earlier had standoff with one another. Okay, so they are going to, you know, bring peace and tranquility at the border areas. Okay, so with this, now let us move to the next article for the day. This article was this article is important under, you know, Indian polity and governance section. Okay, this article says future state. Okay, means at the present time we have, you know, union territories of Ladakh and Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, on one hand we have Jammu and Kashmir as the union territory, okay, one of the union territory, then we have, you know, Ladakh as another union territory, but both these union territories were earlier known as state of Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, so like, you know, like last year the central government has abrogated Article 370 of the Constitution of India, and after abrogation of Article 370 of the Constitution of India, the status of statehood of the Jammu and Kashmir was also dissolved, and they have created two new union territories. One of the union territories, Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir with legislature, and then Union Territory of Ladakh, okay, without a legislature. Okay, so they have created these two union territories, and after creation of these two union territories, okay, like many of the political, you know, persons from these two states were also put into house arrest. Okay, now the central government has shown willingness to engage in dialogues with these leaders, okay, with the leaders of Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, so for that purpose, the Prime Minister of India has recently held, okay, an in-house meeting in the residence of the Prime Minister of India itself. And in that meeting, they have had some consultation between one another. They have discussed on the way forward. And so, you know, this particular article is in that respect. And you need to understand one thing. After the abrogation of Article 370 of the Constitution of India, various parties who were aggrieved by the action of the central government, okay, they have approached the Supreme Court of India. And Supreme Court of India has admitted the case. The Supreme Court of India has not yet, you know, given its verdict or, you know, heard the matter. But like they have admitted the case. So at this point of time, the case is sub judice. Sub judice means the case is in the hand of the courts. Now, you know, like general public meeting or, you know, general talks relate, you know, between these parties in the public arena will be prejudicial to the, you know, prejudicial to the authority of the courts. So it can be considered by the courts as contempt of court. Okay, so that's why the meetings that they have had, okay, that the Prime Minister has had with the leaders of the states, okay, so they have had an in-house meeting and they did not provide any, you know, any clear you know, things that they have consulted. Okay, so that's why nationwide, you know, publication of these things are a little bit, you know, restricted. Why? Because like it may amount to contempt of the court. Okay, so that is one thing. Now, having understood the matter, now let us understand that after the political leaders from the Jammu and Kashmir have had meeting with the Prime Minister, they have come out with a sense of satisfaction. Okay, so they have came out with a sense of optimism that restoration of statehood, it somewhere is somewhere on the horizon. Means like they are now expecting, they are now optimistic that statehood of Jammu and Kashmir may be restored by the central government. Okay, and at the same time, the total reversal of the withdrawal of the special status remains unlikely. Means when the state of Jammu and Kashmir enjoyed a special status, under that they have had, you know, unique provisions. One of the provision is, you know, like citizenship rights. Okay, they have had their own constitution and they had, you know, special rights to the local people in case of purchasing of land and other rights. But after abrogation of Article 370, all those special rights were curtailed. Now, the thing is, like, although the statehood may be restored to the state of Jammu and Kashmir in near future, but like it seems very unlikely that the special status will be restored. Okay, so it is unlikely. It is not that easy. Okay, so now what has happened? The restoration of the statehood. Okay, the author over here says that like if you know, after the initial consultation, the central government should take the first step to restore the, you know, statehood to this particular state, and after then, you know, they should move forward for other, you know, other relaxations. But the thing is, you know, the author is saying that like this restoration of statehood should not be a long drawn process that culminates into, you know, like after, you know, lots of meetings, it should not amount to restoration of statehood. The author is saying the restoration of the statehood should happen at the initial stage itself. Okay, and after then other things may be talked about. Okay, but like it should not be the case vice versa, where like statehood is restored at the end after, you know, lot of, you know, deliberations, consultations and all. Okay, so this is one thing. And apart from this, we are going to have, you know, some other discussion on the same thing. So let us see some more, you know, relevant things with reference to this article. So after decades of turmoil, okay, so there was a decade of turmoil in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, and it has created unique problems of governance and mistrust. Okay, so two regional parties of the state of Jammu and Kashmir are National Conference and People's Democratic Party. Okay, so NC and People's Democratic Party PDP. Okay, so here, like, you know, National Conference, we have, you know, Omar Abdullah, and so Abdullahs are the leaders of National Conference. If we talk about Mehbooba Mufti, she is the leader of People's Democratic Party PDP of Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, so now, in deciding to engage them and other parties, the center has made a departure from its earlier position. Okay, so earlier center was adamant, it was not, you know, in a mood to consult or, you know, listen to the state, you know, state local political parties. But there seems that, like, you know, there has been little international pressure also. So internationally, this thing has been, you know, debated widely. And apart from this, there has been criticism from the state of Jammu and Kashmir itself. People were not happy about it, okay, from the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So now, the central government has taken a, you know, modest step. Now they are, you know, negotiating with the leaders of the, you know, Jammu and Kashmir, okay. By seizing the opportunity, the parties also showed maturity, okay. So these parties have also, you know, taken this particular, you know, opportunity to meet the Prime Minister, and this is being seen as a maturity from the state government. Global and domestic factors, okay, global and domestic factors might have had nudged the center towards what appears to be a tentative accommodation of other viewpoints, okay. So here the author has written a very good, you know, point, okay. So let us discuss what that good point was written by the author. Okay, you can use that particular point in your mains answer. Okay, but the political challenge is to decision to hollow the Article 370 is all but fading. The restoration of statehood has been placed so far down the path that any discussion on a special status is unthinkable in the near future, okay. So the author is saying that the restoration of the statehood has been placed so far down the path, means, like, you know, restoration of a statehood itself seems to be a very distant path, and then, like, you know, restoration of the special statehood is unthinkable at this point of time, okay. This is a very good line by the author, and in that sense the center has irreversibly reset the conversation on Jammu and Kashmir, that success should not blind them to the resentment among the people, okay. Although the central government was successful in, you know, abrogating the article and, you know, making these this particular state two union territories, but, like, it has led to a wide, you know, resentment among the people of the state, okay. So with this, now let us move to the next article, okay. This is article number 4. And this article is very, very important, okay, for the mains examination, okay. So this is a very, you know, a very in-depth written article by the author, and this relates to Indian society, women and health, okay. So under women and health, we can cover this particular article. It is a very important article for the day, okay. So now let us read what the headline is, okay. The headline says, relevant advice for healthcare givers, mothers to be, okay. So there has been a relevant advice, okay, the author is giving relevant advice to the healthcare givers, means, like, health professionals, and the pregnant mothers, those people, like, who are going to be mother, okay. So the this advice is, you know, given by the author to healthcare givers and the mothers to be, okay. So the image that you can see over here, this is the image of a, you know, pregnant woman, means a woman who expects her delivery very soon, okay. So this is the image that depicts that thing, okay. So now let us see what the, you know, subheading says. The subheading says, with COVID-19 compounding maternal and neonatal complications, vaccination and special facilities must be priorities, okay. So the author is saying that COVID-19 is compounding the maternal and neonatal complications, means COVID-19 is, you know, increasing the complications for maternal and neonatal, means, like, you know, for mother and the, you know, to be born child, okay. So vaccination and special facilities must be considered as priorities, okay. So that's the article all about. We are going to discuss in detail. He has written very good points in this particular article. Okay. So author says that India's demographic dividend is largely dependent on its high birth rate. Okay. So India has a demographic dividend, means like, you know, larger portion of India's population is young. Okay. So that means like India is at a stage to, you know, reap the benefit of the young population. And what is the main cause of demographic dividend for India? The main cause for demographic dividend is high birth rate in India. Okay. And the author is saying that the number of births in India is around 72,000 per day. Okay. So every day India gives birth to 72,000 child. Okay. Taking into account 10 months of duration of gestation and pregnancy losses. Okay. So during this process, the mother goes through, you know, a gestation period and pregnancy time. So all this includes around 10 months. Okay. So the number of pregnant women on any single day will be much larger. Okay. So the thing is, if we talk about, this is the number of births that is happening per day. But like if we talk about, you know, number of pregnant women on any particular day, this is going to be much larger than this particular figure, because that pregnancy duration itself is, you know, 9 to 10 months. 9 months is the pregnancy duration. Then like we have, you know, other days also that are counted, you know, post delivery or post labor. Okay, so like there is other time. So the number of women who are pregnant is much higher. Okay, so currently the number of new cases of COVID-19 per day and number of daily COVID-19 deaths in India are among the highest in the world. Okay, so India is now reporting, you know, very high number of COVID-19 cases per day, and at the same time the number of deaths in India because of COVID-19 is highest in the world. Okay, the maternity service in India, both public and private. Okay, when we talk about maternity service, means services that are given to the pregnant mother and her newborn child. Okay, already overburdened with large numbers even in pre-COVID-19 times, face a crisis situation with the condition caused by the pandemic. Okay, earlier, even before COVID-19 time, okay, the private healthcare facilities and public healthcare facilities both had, you know, resource crunch. Okay, so they had lesser, you know, professionals to, you know, support the pregnant women, and they had, you know, lesser equipments with them. But this particular complication or problem has been aggravated, it has been increased because of COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, so this is the context in which this article is in news. Now apart from this, let us talk about, you know, other areas of this particular article. Here the author says about a danger. Okay, what danger the author is talking about? The author says that the recent report from Kerala on pregnant mothers. Okay, so Kerala government, Kerala is a state in India, in South India. Okay, so recent reports from Kerala on pregnant mothers, okay, have uncovered many serious medical problems faced by pregnant women who contact COVID-19 and newborn. Okay, so according to the recent report from the Kerala government, okay, or like Kerala, from the healthcare facilities of Kerala, they have, you know, they have reported that, like, you know, the pregnant mothers or lactating mothers or newborn babies face, you know, lot of problems. What are the problems that they are facing? One of the problem is preeclampsia. Okay, so preeclampsia is a medical condition that pregnant women face. Okay, so like this is a medical condition. Okay, this is a medical condition. Then we have preterm labor, maternal infections. Okay, increased cesarean section rates, fetal growth restrictions due to placenta insufficiency, stillbirth, neonatal infections and respiratory distress. Okay, so these are the problems that are, you know, that may happen to a woman who is pregnant or lactating mother. Okay, so according to a recent publication in the Journal of American Medical Association. Okay, so in the Journal of American Medical Association, there was a recent publication, and according to that publication, they have mentioned that maternal mortality is several fold higher in COVID-19 positive pregnant mothers than in non-COVID pregnant women. Okay, so this particular journal of American Medical Association says that, like, you know, those mothers who have COVID-19, the maternal mortality rate is very high as compared to those mothers who are non-COVID-19, or, like, you know, they are non-COVID positive patients. Okay, so those people who are COVID positive and at the same time pregnant, so maternal mortality is very high. What is maternal mortality? It is the number of women who die, okay, who are pregnant, okay, the women who are dying during the pregnancy, that is known as maternal mortality. Okay, the exact definition includes of numbers also. In your free time, you can, you know, look forward for the exact definition of maternal mortality, child mortality, under 5 mortality, neonatal mortality. Okay, so there are so many, you know, associated definitions like that. Okay, so many pregnant women need admission to the intensive care unit and prolonged hospital. Okay, there are many pregnant women who need ICU facilities and they need prolonged hospitalization. Okay, they need to stay in hospital for a long period. Okay, all of the COVID-19 deaths in pediatric age group, neonatal deaths are the most common. Okay, so neonatal deaths are most common. Apart from this, all maternal and neonatal complications increase with maternal obesity and diabetes in the pregnancy. Okay, so those women who are very obese means who are fat, okay, means like who are fat, okay, they are unhealthy, and like if they also happen to have diabetes, so in that case the risk of maternal mortality increases. Okay, these problems are common in pregnant women in India. Okay, these facts underscore the need for urgent action to minimize the impact of coronavirus infection on pregnant mothers and newborn babies. Okay, so this is the danger that the author talks about. Apart from this, let us also read this article in depth. Okay, so there is an urgent need. Okay, there is an urgent need for action from professional bodies to avert serious calamity. The government, in consultation with these bodies, should immediately facilitate counseling and a care for women in reproductive age group and provide resources to healthcare professionals involved in their care. Okay, so the author is suggesting some way forward, that what is the, you know, recent requirement, what should be done. Okay, So the author is suggesting that professional bodies should take immediate steps to avert the incumbent serious calamity. Okay, and the government should also consult these expert bodies to, you know, formulate some policies and take timely decisions. Okay, in this regard, and quite early during the course of COVID-19 pandemic, we cautioned about the potential adverse effects of COVID-19 in pregnancy and asked preconceptional advice for women planning a pregnancy during the COVID-19 times. A simple precaution that could have averted serious problems for large number of women in the reproductive age group. Okay, so it is the high time that, like, you know, pregnant women or those people like who are willing to have a child, they should, you know, go forward for a family planning, and they should delay the process of pregnancy. Why? Because, like, it is COVID-19 time, and if any of the partner happens to be a COVID positive, then the, you know, risk of the other partner or other spouse also becomes very high to get affected by COVID-19, and this may result into the whole family, you know, getting COVID positive, and the newborn baby may be in danger, okay, because of this particular thing. So what steps do we need to take? Okay, so the author is saying that, like, we need to take two important steps. One of the steps is to advise all women to postpone pregnancy till both partners are vaccinated. Okay, one of the thing is all women should be advised to postpone the pregnancy till both the partners are vaccinated first. Second thing is, okay, they should offer vaccination to all unvaccinated pregnant women. Okay, one thing is, like, you know, like pregnancy should be you know, postponed until both the partners are vaccinated. Second thing is, you know, those women who are not vaccinated yet, they should also be vaccinated soon. Okay, this is the thing. Okay, so apart from this, let us read some you know, more steps related thing that needs to be done. Okay, so the author is saying temporary and reversible contraception, okay, during COVID-19 time is a simple and effective way to postpone pregnancies. Okay, so like people should use contraception during the pregnancy, okay, to avert or to postpone pregnancies and thereby decrease the number of women who would otherwise seek antenatal advice in crowded hospitals and seek exposure to the infection. Okay, so the demands on healthcare personnel who provide antenatal care would decrease. Okay, so if women are postponing their pregnancy, what will happen? These women will not have to, you know, go to the hospitals and seek antenatal care, which are already overcrowded. Okay, and at the same time, the burden on the healthcare professionals, okay, will decrease, and the demand for more healthcare professionals will reduce for the time being. Okay, so reduction in the number of antenatal visits, online consultation, protocols for ultrasonography, glucose tolerance test, and antepartum fetal evaluation have been introduced by many institutions. Okay, so many of the institutions have introduced these measures. What are those measures? Like, they have, you know, reduced the number of, you know, antenatal visits by introducing online consultation. Then they have, you know, also introduced some kind of protocols for ultrasonography, okay, glucose tolerance test, and antepartum fetal evaluation. Okay, these things have been introduced by the institutions, and this must be followed by all caregivers. Okay, ultrasound scans are routinely done during pregnancy. Dedicated and safe ultrasound scan centers for pregnant women manned exclusively by immunized personnel is a need of the hour. Okay, so the author is saying that, like, you know, regular ultrasound scans are important during pregnancy. So that's why it is the right time that, like, you know, we should have these centers, these ultrasound scanning centers, to be manned, to be, you know, supported by those healthcare givers who are completely vaccinated. Okay, and apart from this, pregnant women with fewer with fever should be considered to have COVID-19. The author is saying those women who are pregnant and who have fever, they should be considered that they are COVID-19 positive patients, okay, unless proved otherwise. Means the preconception, or like the idea is, like, those pregnant women who are having fever, they will be considered as COVID positive patients, and accordingly they will be treated in separate wards. Okay, why? Because this will result in, you know, lesser, you know, contact of COVID-19 with other patients. Okay, and apart from this, the author also suggests that at present, COVID-19 and non-COVID-19 pregnant women, okay, author says that the COVID-19 and non-COVID-19 pregnant women who are coming to the hospitals are treated in similar fashion by all the healthcare professionals. But the author is suggesting that, like, you know, COVID positive patients must be, you know, treated separately, and they should be given separate wards, and COVID-19 negative patients should be given different wards, and all the healthcare givers who are, you know, providing services to these people, all of them should be vaccinated. And if some of the healthcare professionals are not vaccinated, they should be vaccinated as soon as possible. Okay, so this is one of the thing that is, you know, that is said by the author. And apart from this, the author also makes a point about the clear benefits of vaccination. Okay, so what are the benefits of vaccination? Okay, so the author makes a clear point by you know putting some kind of arguments. Okay, so the author says that in general, inactivated virus vaccines are safe during pregnancy. Okay, in general, inactivated virus vaccines are safe during pregnancy, and the World Health Organization has given a nod to the use of the inactivated Sinovac vaccine. Okay, so WHO has, World Health Organization has approved, okay, this particular vaccine, which is known as Sinovac vaccine, okay, for COVID-19 patients, okay, and especially for pregnant women. Therefore, inactivated vaccine available in India, which is Covaxin, okay, Covaxin is an inactivated vaccine which is available in India, may have advantages over the vectored vaccine, which is COVID Shield and Sputnik, for vaccinating pregnant women. So the author is suggesting that for vaccinating pregnant women, we should use Covaxin because it is an inactivated, you know, vaccine. However, these are like COVID Shield and Sputnik, these are vectored vaccines. Okay, so what is the way forward? The author finally suggests these way forwards. Okay, so he says that the availability and advantages of the vaccine for pregnant women should be published and awareness should be created among the public. Okay, so you know, availability and advantages of the vaccine should be, you know, should be talked about with the pregnant women, so that like they become aware of the benefits of, you know, getting vaccinated. And at the same time, the vaccine hesitancy is very high among pregnant women, so they should be counseled and they should be talked about, you know, they should be given information, the benefits of, you know, getting vaccinated through effect through education and effective communication. Okay, and the author says that the professional bodies recommended to the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare that vaccination be offered to pregnant women after providing adequate information and counseling. Okay, there are many professional bodies. These professional bodies have advised the Ministry of Health and Women that vaccination should be provided, okay, to the pregnant women after giving them, you know, adequate information and counseling. And the Indian Council of Medical Research and the Ministry of Health have approved this particular step. Okay, and if you follow this particular link, you will be able to, you know, read the, you know, approval by these two, you know, bodies, Indian Council of Medical Research and Ministry of Health. Okay, so India will do well to enhance vaccination coverage of couples planning pregnancy and pregnant women on a priority basis in order to protect others and their newborn. Okay, so the author is very optimistic about it, that if we do it, so India will be at a higher footing to, you know, save the, you know, couples who are expecting, you know, expecting a child soon, and the newborns will also be saved. Okay, so these are the, you know, points that are put forward by the author. So this is a very good and elaborately written article. You should be, you know, reading this article once again, and we are going to share the PDF, okay, in our Telegram channel. So if you have not joined any our Telegram channel, you can visit our, you know, YouTube, and then you can go to the description. There will be a link of our Telegram channel. Join the Telegram channel and you will be able to access the PDF of this particular discussion. Okay, now let us take the next question for next topic for the day. This is the last topic that we are going to discuss. This topic is related to internal security of India. Okay, let us read the heading. When greyhounds struck in a fading red zone. Okay, what is greyhound? Okay, what is greyhound? Greyhound is a specially trained force, okay, to combat the left wing extremism in the left wing affected areas. Okay, like Naxalites, Maoist and all. Okay, so greyhounds are specially trained forces for combating the left wing extremism. Okay, so, and fading red zone, what do we mean by fading red zone? Okay, red zone are those, you know, zones, those areas that are highly infested by left wing extremism, that are, you know, under the under the control of the left-wing extremism. But like there are some areas that there are some zones where the left-wing extremism has reduced a lot. That is known as fading red zones. Okay. So now this particular article talks about a recent incident where the Greyhounds have killed, okay, some of the leaders of the, you know, left-wing extremism, like Maoist leaders. Okay. So let us see what is the context of this particular article. So in June, in the month of June, six Maoists, including top leaders from the CPI Maoists, were killed by the Greyhounds. Okay. So six leaders from CPI Maoists, okay, CPI Maoists have been killed by the Greyhounds in Koyuru Mandal in Vishakhapatnam Agency. Reports on the setback of the movement, which is already at its lowest ebb in the region. Okay. So now, where is Vishakhapatnam? This is the location of Vishakhapatnam in the map. Okay. See the map over here. This is the location of Vishakhapatnam. At present time, Vishakhapatnam is located in Andhra Pradesh, but in undivided Andhra Pradesh. Okay. Where Telangana and Andhra Pradesh were same. So Andhra Pradesh and Telangana both were infested by the left-wing extremism or Maoist, okay, Maoism. So at this point of time, here they have conducted the operation over here to kill the, you know, leaders of the left-wing extremism. Okay. So now in that perspective, let us understand about Greyhounds. Okay. So what are Greyhounds? The Greyhound, I have already discussed, this is a special trained forces, okay. Greyhounds was raised in 1989 by the IPS officer K.S. Vyas in an elite anti-Maoist force, okay. It is an elite anti-Maoist force. It has been raised by an IPS officer K.S. Vyas, okay. Seeing its successful operations, many states facing the Maoist problem have raised their own forces, okay. So this particular force, Greyhound, have, you know, conducted many successful operations, and seeing its success, many other states have also raised their own forces. Okay. So training for the Greyhounds is grueling. Okay. And members of the force cannot be over 35 years. Okay. So under this force, all those personnels that are serving, they are less than 35 years. The moment they cross the age of 35 years, they are, you know, sent back to the normal police, normal state police. Okay. So up to the age of 35 years, they can be in that particular, you know, Greyhounds force. And these people are highly trained, you know, personnel. So being young gives us an edge in terms of agility, strength and stamina. Okay. It is the statement that was made by a Greyhound officer. Okay. So here you can see the image of the Greyhound officers. Okay. So this is the image of Greyhound officers. These are, you know, Greyhound officers who actually, you know, fight against left-wing extremism. Okay. Then during combat operations, each party of the Greyhound has about 30 men who are trained to track long distances. Okay. So each party of the Greyhound has about 30 members. They are trained to track long distances, and, you know, they live only on dry fruits, and, you know, they live for 5 to 6 days in forested regions. Okay. So the members of the members communicate with the base using satellite phones or VHF sets and use scramblers to avoid being intercepted by the Maoist. The Maoist have expertise to intercept radio communication. Okay. So this is about the Greyhounds. Now let us talk about how this particular movement has, you know, taken its birth, and what is the location where, like, India sees left-wing extremism. Okay. Okay. So this is the map of India's Maoist conflict. Okay. So these locations that you can see over here. Okay. These locations, like Andhra Pradesh, Telangana border, and Chhattisgarh, then Jharkhand, these are the areas where we find, you know, maximum number of people, okay, from the, you know, Maoist section who have infested this particular region. I mean, like normal people are not there. I mean, means like normal people are there. I mean, you know, so these regions are affected by the Maoist conflict, okay, in India. And apart from this, if we talk about how this particular movement has taken birth, okay, in undivided Andhra Pradesh, the seed of the armed struggle was sown by the Telangana rebellion of 1946, okay, in the state of Andhra Pradesh. The seed of this particular rebellion started in 1946, okay, that is known as Telangana rebellion, okay. So the peasant movement, it was a peasant movement, it was led by communist leaders, okay. This particular peasant movement was led by communist leaders. Their names are mentioned over here, okay. They rebelled against the feudal lords of the Telangana region in the princely state of Hyderabad, and the armed struggle ended in 1951. When the last of the guerrilla squads were subdued by the police force, okay. So this is the thing. Now let us understand little more about, you know, the birth of the movement, like how the movements started, okay. And still the armed forces are now trying to, you know, curb these movements, okay. The armed forces are you know, highly trained, and they are taking timely operations to actually combat any unforeseen situation in the near future, okay. So through the Sri Kakulam movement, okay, though the Sri Kakulam movement, which began in 1967, was squashed, it inspired leaders such as these leaders, okay, in the early part of 1980s, okay. So this particular movement, which is known as Sri Kakulam movement, which started in 1967, it was squashed, means like it was overthrown. But later on, this particular movement have inspired other leaders also, and that movement started in 1980, okay. The movement grew in parts of what is now called Telangana, okay. This movement started in present day Telangana, in the you know, districts of Warangal, Khammam, Adilabad and Karimnagar. Okay, it was during Kondapalli's leadership, okay, Kondapalli was one of the leader, that the current crop of Maoist leader such as former general secretary, like these people who were killed, okay, were trained, okay, during this particular time period. The movement grew due to operation by feudal landlords and attempts by zamindars to take over the lands from the tribals, okay. So the movement initially started against the landlords and zamindars who, you know, tried to take over the lands of the tribals. But like, you know, that movement is still continuous, and many of the leaders have recently been killed. And so, like, you know, the combat operation keeps on happening between the armed forces and, okay, and these militants. Okay, militants means these, you know, Maoist people. So that's all that I had to discuss with you for the day. Thank you so much, everyone, for attending the session. I hope you have a great day ahead. Thank you.
Contact us to avail the combo offer of General Studies and Public Administration optional with 20% discount.